Hello friends, so here we're going to start the most important, most difficult, most vast chapter for in organic in chemistry of 10th standard, which is nothing but organic chemistry. So organic chemistry has totally six parts. So now we'll be going part by part, and the first part is nothing but the introduction, which is nothing but the basics of organic chemistry, which you might have learnt in your lower classes. So now we'll start off with the first topic, which is nothing but differences between an organic compound and an ionic compound. Yeah, so now the first topic which you're going to do is the basic differences between an organic compounds and non-organic compounds or the ionic compounds. So now I've written down the key points here, so I'll be explaining one by one. So the first one is supposed to be the elements present. So now when you take an ionic compound an ionic compound has only two parts. So first one is supposed to be a cation and second one is supposed to be an anion, and these are the basics. So cation is supposed to be a positively charged substance, anion is a negatively charged substance. So a positively charged cation and a negatively charged anion, which is present in an ionic compound, has a force in between it, and this force is supposed to be known as electrostatic force of attraction. So this electrostatic force of attraction is basically a very strong force. It's a very strong force that the melting point and the boiling point of such ionic compounds will be very, very high. So now basically the elements present is in an ionic form, and this ionic form is supposed to be nothing but a cation and an anion. But when you take an organic compound, we use the word hydrocarbons to describe all the organic compounds. So what do you mean by a hydrocarbon? A hydrocarbon is basically a compound with hydrogen and carbon as the main elements. So, but you might have seen few questions, like the empirical formula based questions, where they will give you the percentage of hydrogen and the percentage of carbon. But then when you add up the percentage of hydrogen and carbon, which are the basic components of a hydrocarbon, it will not add up to 100. That means there is another element which makes it 100%. So the third element is oxygen, which is rarely found in a hydrocarbon. The main elements of a hydrocarbon is hydrogen and carbon, and the other one is oxygen. So the elemental difference is, first, in an ionic compound you have a cation and an anion with an electrostatic force of attraction, and then an organic compound which has hydrogen, carbon, and sometimes even oxygen is also present. So now the next point is something about solubility. So now the solubility, basically there is a statement which says like dissolves like. What do you mean by like dissolves like? The bonding in the substance and the bonding in your, which is the solute and the solvent, the bonding present in the solute plus the solvent must always be the same. That's why we say like dissolves like. For example, water. You must have learned in your lower classes that water is nothing but a polar compound. A polar compound is nothing but which has an mild ionic bond. But when you take compounds like methane, ethane, or propane, which are nothing but basic organic compounds, they do not have these polar bonds. They are nothing but organic compound which has a covalent bond. So because of which we say like does not dissolve the other one, because like dissolves like. But then we take water plus methane or ethane or any other hydrocarbon, it is not soluble because the bonding is different. While when you take water and NaCl, like dissolves like, the statement is applicable because the bonding in NaCl, the bonding in water, both are the same. So NaCl can be dissolved in water. The like dissolves like statement can be applicable. That is what they mean by solubility. So first, when you take solubility in water, so the conclusion is that organic compounds cannot be soluble in
Next
water.
One is supposed to be bonding.
As I've discussed in each and every point, ionic bond is present in the case of NaCl, while covalent bond is present in the case of methane. And you know the consequences of the bonding in the case of solubility, in the case of melting point and boiling point. So now next one is nothing but conductivity. So now the conductivity is basically because of your positively charged and negatively charged ions, which is a cation or an anion. So now when you take, for example, NaCl, which has Na plus and Cl minus, now since this because of the bonding of this compound, you can dissolve it in water. So NaCl can easily be dissolved in water. So when you dissolve it in water, you'll be getting Na plus and Cl minus. Electrolysis occurs. This is known as electrolysis. Electrolysis occurs, which we'll be doing in subsequent, I'll be teaching in detail in subsequent videos. So because of this electrolysis, the splitting of the ions take place, because of which conduction becomes easier. While we take covalent bonding, there's no cation or no anion. So because of which conduction of electricity is supposed to be very, very less. Conductivity in the sense electrical conductivity, not thermal conductivity. So this is it about your conductivity in the case of ionic compounds. So the basic reason why ionic compounds conduct electricity is that because of the positive charge and a negative charge is present in an ionic compound. While we take an organic compound, such positive and negative charges are absent.
Yeah.
So now first we saw solubility in water. So now next you're going to see solubility in organic solvents. So now, as I said, like dissolves like. So when you take organic compounds like methane, ethane or propane, since the bonding in ethane, methane and propane are the same as the bonding present in such organic solvents, like for instance CCl4, so they are soluble. So all these organic compounds will be soluble in CCl4. So what is the next one? What is the basic structure of CCl4? You must have done it in chemical bonding chapter, but anyways, C1, 2, 3, and 4. This is the basic structure of CCl4, and then this is most widely used in all the labs for which acts as an organic solvent. Any other organic compound can be stored using this organic solvent, and even carbon tetrachloride. Why do you call it tetrachloride? 4 chlorine atoms are present in this. So now the next one, apart from the organic solvents, so next point is even melting point and boiling point. So now melting point and boiling point, as I said, the main reason behind the low melting point and boiling point in the case of organic compounds or higher melting point or boiling point in the case of ionic compounds is because of the bonding precedent. Since the electrostatic force of attraction between the cation and then an anion is supposed to be very, very high, it's very strong, because of which the melting point and boiling point is supposed to be very, very high. Like you can actually go and Google the values of melting point and boiling point of sodium chloride and melting point and boiling point of methane. Such values need not be memorized, but for you to understand better why the difference is there, it's because of the bonding. So now this is it about melting point and boiling point, as I have mentioned. Okay, so now the next one which I'm going to do is isomerism. So isomerism is supposed to be nothing but a compound which has the same molecular formula but different structural formula. So what do you mean by molecular formula? Molecular formula in the sense the number of atoms. Like for example, if a compound CH4, if you take a compound like CH4, that means the two elements are C and H. The number of elements must be the same in both the molecular formulae that you write. What is structural formula? Structural formula, in a sense, you represent this in the form or in the form of a structure. For example, CH4 will be represented as there's one carbon and then there's four hydrogen bonds. This is what you mean by structural formula. Normally, the structural formula will be different, while the molecular formula, that means number of carbon atoms or hydrogen atoms or oxygen atoms, it will be the same in both the compounds. So now, and you'll be doing isomerism in detail with all its type in the subsequent videos. But now isomerism is shown by organic compounds. All organic compounds show isomerism, but ionic compounds do not show isomerism. So in the differences, this fact is enough. So now the next point is nothing but smell, color, appearance. So now, normally when you consider these facts, so now we know that there is a class of organic compounds, and this class is known as aromatic compounds. So now, as the name suggests, aromatic compound is supposed to be the one which has a smell, aroma, it has a smell. So now esters are supposed to be a type of aromatic compounds which has a fruity smell or sweet smell. It has a sweet smell. So this is one example of organic compounds. There are many examples where the organic compound has a distinct smell, and then there's a distinct color also in most of the organic compounds. Like for example, carbon tetrachloride has a slight yellowish orange. Mostly we use the word yellow, but then yellowish orange is the color for carbon tetrachloride. But then when you take all the ionic compounds do not have a distinct smell, they do not have a distinct color. This is the basic difference between the ionic compound and organic compound with respect to color, smell, appearance. So now apart from the next one is known as combustibility. What do you mean by combustibility? Organic compounds, they catch fire easily. That is what you mean by combustible. That one fact is enough for you to differentiate between ionic and organic compounds. So normally ionic compounds, they do not catch fire easily, which is also one of the differences. And you can look at your textbook, it's a huge tabular column which has around 10 points or something. I have covered the important points which basically require some explanation. The rest of it you can actually look into it and then you can.
So please do like, share and subscribe to my channel. Hit the bell icon below. And then if you have any queries, any comments, any doubts regarding the videos, please do leave comments below. Thank you so much.